You know that feeling you get when you find a new band that speaks to your soul, that you love everything about them? You just have to share it with everyone you meet. Well, that's how I'm feeling right now about a band I just discovered, but unfortunately, I don't get to meet many people these days. So I'm gonna share it with you. This band is amazing. Besides having a really unique sound that is fun and engaging, it just makes you want to sing along with them. The content of their music really touches my Christian heart. There's a sense of longing and searching in everything that they produce, grappling with big questions like faith and doubt, love and loss, sin and grace, shame and redemption, hope and despair. And get this, they're a secular band. Their lyrics are packed full of literary references from the Bible, Shakespeare, G.K. Chesterton, Steinbeck, and so much more. There's just a lot going on. So who is this incredible band that I've just discovered and absolutely have to tell you about? Well, none other than the multi-platinum megastars, Mumford & Sons. Okay, so maybe I didn't just discover them. They've been around for more than a decade, and I was actually a fan of theirs way back in college. But over the past month, I've listened to them a lot more, really started to dive into their lyrics, and have come to appreciate them in a whole new light. They are, without a doubt, my favorite band at this point, and I really think that they might have the best Christian music out there, even if they don't even consider themselves Christian. Let me explain. There's no question that the essence of their music is faith-based. The lead singer is a preacher's kid, and he grew up a zealous Christian. Much of his worldview is influenced by that reality, and it comes out in his music. There is something inside him that seeks God. One of the most prevalent themes in their music, particularly early on, is the sense of excitement that comes with discovery. There's a joy in his voice, an openness to the unknown, a desire to run towards the light. In Awake My Soul, he sings,
"Now my heart stumbles on things I don't know. My weakness I feel I must finally show. Lend me your hand and we'll conquer them all. But lend me your heart and I'll just let you fall. Lend me your eyes, I can change what you see. But your soul you must keep totally free."
Something is happening. Something is welling up. The chorus repeats over and over, "Awake my soul, awake my soul." In the song, "I Will Wait," we get the sense of someone new to faith, filled with hope and completely trusting of what's ahead.
"Now I'll be bold, as well as strong, and use my head alongside my heart. So tame my flesh and fix my eyes, a tethered mind freed from the lies. And I'll kneel down, wait for now. I'll kneel down, no.
This is followed, like before, with a catchy and upbeat chorus repeating, I will wait for you." Maybe my favorite of all in this vein is their hit, "The Cave," a beautiful story of conversion and new life.
"It's empty in the valley of your heart. The sun, it rises slowly as you walk away from all the fears and all the faults you've left behind. The harvest left no food for you to eat. You cannibal, you meat eater, you see. But I've seen the same, I know the shame in your defeat."
Okay, so we've got a dejected person here, someone with a fruitless life, walking away from their problems. They're trying to hide their shame, but the author can see it. The chorus follows, second verse, chorus again, and then the third verse, the key to it all.
"So come out of your cave walking on your hands and see the world hanging upside down. You can understand dependence when you know the maker's land."
If you're a fan of G.K. Chesterton, the point of the song clicks into place with this line. Listen to what he writes in his biography of St. Francis. Francis, at the time or somewhere about the time when he disappeared into the prison or the dark cavern, underwent a reversal of a certain psychological kind. The man who went into the cave was not the man who came out again. He looked at the world as differently from other men, as if he had come out of the dark hole Walking on His Hands. Mumford & Sons made a hit song about conversion, subtly using a reference to St. Francis to make their point. How freaking cool is that? After this, the final verse and chorus come in triumphant, the words of a man with a new take on life. Someone no longer enticed by the temptations of the world, but simply wanting to be the man God made him to be.
Make your sirens call and sing all you want. I will not hear what you have to say, 'cause I need freedom now, and I need to know how to live my life as it's meant to be.
Something about this line that just really gets me. The sense of a man who lived a wayward life, who didn't know who he was, finding his place, knowing who he was created to be. With God, with this new life, he finally knows who he is. It's no wonder that songs like these, coupled with an upbeat, folksy sound, caught the world by storm in the early part of the last decade. It's the anthem of youth, the wide-eyed experience of discovery and finding your place. It's the joy of first conversion, of being pure and maybe even a bit naive to what lies ahead. Life is good with God on our side. But this feeling doesn't always last, does it? We all come down from this high eventually. In their song 42, we hear of someone who is lost, someone who no longer feels the comfort of faith.
Where do I turn to when there's no choice to make? How do I presume when there's so much at stake? I was so sure of it all. What if I need you in my darkest hour?
Something deep inside, a memory of faith that he once knew, but it eludes him at this moment. The initial fervor of faith has waned, and now, with some deep troubles, he finds himself asking, can I really trust? Can I really put my faith in something I can't fully grasp? These questions and this theme of feeling lost or disconnected are found all throughout Mumford & Sons' music. In one instance, Believe, the theme might be hit a little too squarely on its head, but you get the point.
I don't even know if I believe everything you're trying to say to me. So open up my eyes, tell me I'm alive. This is never gonna go our way. If I'm gonna have to guess what's on your mind.
What a perfect line for that situation, having to guess what's on your mind. Whether the song is specific to God or more generally about being disconnected from someone we love, we all know the feeling of anxiety, of loving someone, wanting to be close to them, but not getting anything from them in return. It's as if he's saying, just tell me what to do. Just tell me how to love you. There are times of doubt when God seems distant. Sometimes this is simply the nature of faith, of believing in someone that can't be proven mathematically, leaving us feeling abandoned and confused even when we're not. But sometimes it's the result of our own doing. There are times we feel lost, not because God has left us, but because we've left God and don't know if we can get back. For that, we have broken crown.
Touch my mouth and hold my tongue. I'll never be your chosen one. I'll be home, safe and tucked away. Will you contempt me if I don't see the day?
Verse 1, we've got someone strong in their morals, knowing what's right and wrong and sticking to their boundaries. For now. Verse 2.
Pull on my flesh was just too strong, stifled the choice and the air in my lungs. Better not to breathe and to breathe a lie. Cause when I open my body, I breathe a lie.
He fights and he fights, trying to avoid the temptation. But in the end, he can't help himself. He gives into the flesh, falling to sin.
But oh, my heart was flawed, I knew my weakness. So hold my hand, consign me not to darkness.
Now all he can feel is regret. He knows they shouldn't have done that. He knows the penalty of sin and initially seeks mercy. But this too fades. The song ends with a dramatic climax as he shouts three times. Just like the serpent in Genesis, he has fallen short, and so resigns himself to a horrible fate. He will never be worthy, in his eyes, to wear the broken crown, an allusion to Christ's crown of thorns. Now, as he nears the end of life, God continues to reach out to him with forgiveness, with grace. But he can't accept it, because he can't forgive himself. It's a haunting song, actually. One that you would never hear on Christian radio, but one I think that many Christians can relate to. How can God love me when I continue to mess things up? It's an experience that is all too familiar in the confessional. It's within that context that I can't help but interpret their song Beloved as God's response. Marcus Mumford has said publicly that the song is actually inspired by his last moments with his dying grandmother, and it's beautifully touching in that regard. But play it right after Broken Crown, and I hear something different. This is God's response to the shameful man who can't forgive himself, and so walks away. The chorus goes,
and as you leave, you must know you are beloved. And as you leave, I can see the wild has come for you. And as you leave, I won't hold you back, beloved.
I don't care if this is a love song to a dying grandmother or to a sinner that turns down grace and gives into the wild. It is incredibly touching and just brings me to tears when I think about it. How often we forget that we are actually beloved and need a reminder. So yes, listen to Mumford & Sons and you will find the joy of discovery and the sorrow of feeling lost. But it doesn't stop there. For as anyone who has ever had faith knows, these things can be cyclical. They can exist right alongside each other. And so what you find all throughout their music is a band living in the tension of faith and doubt. In Ghosts That We Knew, we hear of someone lost, but also hopeful.
So give me hope in the darkness that I will see the light. Cause oh, they gave me such a fright. But I will hold as long as you like. Just promise me we'll be alright.
In Holland Road, we get a glimpse of someone who knows that they're flawed and yet has the will to keep going anyway.
But I still believe
though there's cracks you'll see. When I'm on my knees, I still believe. And when I've hit the ground, neither lost nor found, if you believe in me, I still believe.
And how can we ignore Guiding Light, a song that, once again, might be hitting things a little too squarely on the head, but is hopeful nonetheless.
Late in my youth, well, I'm still in awe of you. Discover some new truth. Now is always wrapped around you. But don't just slip away. Unworthy and ashamed. Give us something to believe in, and you know we'll go your way.
In his voice, I hear the countless number of people who went to church as kids, believed strongly at one point, but somehow drifted away. Now they don't pray, they don't go to church, maybe they've made some bad decisions. But through it all, they've never stopped believing. And now they want to rekindle what was once so strong. Again, is this a model of faith? Is it the sort of thing you'd hear on Christian radio? Not at all. But tell me this doesn't speak to droves and droves of people. Those people who believe in God and for whom faith is important, but they're still trying to get their life together. It's this struggle that Mumford & Sons captures so well, because they bare their souls and show the personal challenges that people of faith go through, but also because they don't just present it as a personal struggle. In almost every song, there's a sense of being in it together, of sometimes being held up by others, but sometimes holding others up. Listen to the comforting words of After the Storm.
There will come a time you'll see, with no more tears, and love will not break your heart. But dismiss your fears, get over your hill and see what you find there with grace in your heart and flowers in your hand.
There's the powerful chorus of Tim Schul.
But you are not alone in this, and you are not alone in this. As brothers we will stand and we'll hold your hand. Hold your hand.
Sometimes we just need to hold someone's hand. At times, this hand is one of concern for a friend wandering through life and losing themselves, as in The Wolf. But sometimes, it's far more tragic, as in the hand of someone trying to talk a loved one back from the despair that leads to suicides, as in Hot Gates.
Even in the dark, I saw you were the only one alone. But these are gates you spin, your vitriol. You wouldn't do this anymore, and I can't be for you. All of the things you want me to, but I will love you constantly. This precious little else to me. And though we cry, we must stay alive. Let my blood only run out when my world decides.
And that is what you get from Mumford & Sons. They don't consider themselves a Christian band. They don't even consider themselves Christian. They're uncomfortable with the pitfalls of the organized church of late and don't want that label. They don't know exactly where they're going and are too affected by a postmodern world that is spiritual but distrusts religion. And yet, they are not taken by the shallowness of the world either. There is something out there worth living for. There's something worth believing and loving with your whole heart, and it's not your stuff or a good time or your own ego. This is not New Age spirituality or self-help theology. They know that there's a God and want to love what is right. And so I ask you, how is this not the experience of so many Christians? Just because you have doubts doesn't mean you cease to be a Christian. Just because you fail to use Christ's name doesn't mean that the truth of the gospel or the mission of Christ disappears from sight. Mumford & Sons may be uncomfortable with the title of Christian, and who am I to put that on them? But their music is definitely the sort of stuff that speaks to my Christian heart. Here is a band on a journey of faith, referencing Genesis, Song of Songs, the prophet Daniel, the Gospels, St. Francis of Assisi, a band that once knew clearly the love of Christ and felt fervor for the mission, only to have that questioned a bit of late. They use some language that isn't always family-friendly, and their lyrics shouldn't be confused with the gospel. But think about it this way. They are one of the most popular bands in the world, making music for a largely non-Christian fanbase, and almost every one of their songs forces you to confront major issues of life. That, to me, is absolutely incredible. And I have no doubt that their music has helped countless people struggling in faith, people who probably don't frequent churches or religious YouTube channels. And I think there's something to that. The message doesn't always have to be explicit to be effective. You don't always have to name God or Jesus to speak to people's hearts and to till the soil. There's a need for sure to teach explicitly, to catechize and make known the deposit of faith, but there's also a need to soften someone's heart, to make them feel welcome, to reach them on a human level before you can reach them on a Christian one. For the person who has deep questions but is not sure about religion, for an excuse to have a conversation about faith and doubt, love and loss, sin and grace, shame and redemption, hope and despair. I can't think of a better band to listen to. Oh, and they have a banjo, which is kind of cool too.